I'm Dr. Amanda Parks. I'm the Chief Innovation Officer of both Future Tech Lab and Pangaia, and that's what we're going to be discussing today. We are a materials science brand, so we are driven by R&D and the kind of future of material science, the opportunity that we see for that to really change the industry. Of course, we're focused on sustainability, but I think there's even just sort of like such a larger perspective about what science can do to heal so many of the problems across the globe. And if we really kind of concentrate on getting investment and effort and everything to the right places, then we will be able to have an industry that we are proud of, that we fully respect. We respect all the people in it. We respect our environment, and we have good practices, and we can really enjoy fashion for what it is, which is, you know, the celebration of identity and personal expression and artistry. So we need the back end to be working properly, and that's where we think that science and innovation is coming in. So I'm not seeing Mira yet, so I'm just going to keep kind of chatting. I'll give a little intro to our businesses. Mira and I met 3 years ago. We're actually just approaching our 3 anniversary of working together, which is kind of lovely as a way to celebrate this talk. And we came together around this idea that we both saw that innovation could really heal the industry. And what was interesting about it was I come from deep tech. I have a PhD from the MIT Media Lab that's hybrid between computer science and material science. And before that, I was a mechanical engineer in the Stanford D School. And I'd worked with, you know, a lot of different big companies, big tech companies, as well as founded different startups, some in the wearable space and some in biotech. And I was coming into fashion seeing, wow, there's so much opportunity for change here. You know, they really, big fashion companies don't own the means of their own production. And basically, you know, the kind of the textiles and all the new technology developments were being done by people outside of the industry. And so I wanted to be able to kind of create this bridge into fashion from technology that was really addressing fashion's priorities, right? And so when I met Mira, she had started Future Tech Lab, which is an investment company to start to work on, you know, investments inside of fashion and sustainability, but very much with a focus on high tech, on biotech, on material science, on the things that are not necessarily familiar to, you know, to fashion designers, but, you know, are very important for the back end of the materials that they work with. And we spent basically 2 years of traveling the globe, looking at some of the best innovations across the globe, and visiting laboratories, startups, big companies, basically whatever we could find. And, you know, I had a pretty extensive network inside of academia and startups, and she was coming with an incredible background from fashion media. And so we really tried to kind of hone in on what's the pipeline of opportunities? What are people doing that people don't know about? What are the spaces that are missing? I'm getting a little chat back to Mira, so I think she has to log off and log back in if she can hear me. But kind of impromptu talking now. But so that was how we kind of got into this space of really trying to get. First, it was to get money and kind of interest into the right places. But a bigger part of Mira's vision was always to kind of create a bigger community around this and to kind of make change that also involved product and lifestyle. So we could really be a kind of showcase for this is what you can do when you put the money and the science into the right place. So basically that's kind of how Pangaia grew out of that in this idea of, oh, Maria, are you there?
Hello.
Yay, so good to see you. Sorry, I've just been, I don't know if you can hear me. I've been chatting and kind of introducing FTL and Pangaia while you were missing.
Okay.
But I'd love it if you could, I was talking about our journey together, having worked together with FTL and being around the globe on the search for the very best science and innovation. And maybe you want to give just a little perspective on how you got to this place of, you know, you came from fashion media, and how did you arrive to this vision around what FTL and Pangaia could do for, you know, for the industry?
Yeah, thanks, Amanda. Hi, everyone. Great to be here with you. And yeah, I guess it was, you know, this moment when I met one of the scientists who actually dived me into this world of material sciences and bioengineering, who basically was developing with his partner and growing leather and fur from stem cells. And this really blew my mind, and I thought, how is, you know, that actually even possible? You know, more companies, you know, going forward, you know, we're producing fibers from seaweed, you know, that grows abundantly in the ocean habitat, you know, and this was really, you know, like this kind of an eureka moment, you know, when I realized that, wow, we live at the forefront of such amazing, you know, we always love to say, to call it evolution, because revolution always is quite negative, right? Has quite negative connotation, because always someone has to, I guess, struggle in the revolutions. We hope that everyone's going to be happy and everyone's going to win through this transformation. So yeah, it was really, I think every time, Amanda, we, you know, we are together in yet another laboratory, you know, I behave and I look and I feel just like, you know, a little kid yes. in, I guess, toy store or maybe Disneyland, you know, obviously this is, you're very much, you know, that's your environment, right? And I really am very jealous in a very good way. And so, yeah, it feels just amazing, you know, see how the crazy, amazing scientific brain can really solve so many big environmental, you know, and I guess world's problems. Yeah, it's great to see that, you know, after so many, I guess, disappointments, you know, on different levels, you know, from plastic pollutions to, you know, climate apocalypse to, you know, finding out, you know, about the fact that fashion and apparel industry is one of the most polluting industries in the world, you know, and which was, again, another big shock for me personally, to really see and understand that, yeah, with all these innovations coming, with all this incredible science and amazing scientific brain again, I think all these problems can be solved. And yeah, to me, I don't want to really talk about, you know, how bad the situation is. We all know how, you know, where we are today. And I think we all need to be more positive and to give each other more hope, you know, and support each other in, I guess, you know, all our efforts to make, you know, the state of the world and our world a better place. So yeah, I personally am coming from very positive perspective. I believe that, yeah, we're going towards this really healthy, happy, innovative, circular, zero waste future.
I mean, I think that really like sums up kind of, I think, the attitude about Pangaia is, you know, the whole collective is that we live in the space of solutions. So I think as a scientist, I do feel lucky that I get to see that we have the solutions to solve these problems. I mean, you know, it does feel like you're banging your head out against a wall in terms of a lot of policy and other things that come around it, but the opportunity is there, and it's just about the kind of hard work and also the negotiation. I think, you know, I talk a lot about how my job is more about, you know, scientific diplomacy, right? How do we navigate different people and different situations to get to the right solution? And that's a big part of what, you know, you've done an amazing job at kind of putting together all the people in our collective. And I think one of the things that we talk about internally a lot is how, you know, sustainability is kind of like it's always a series of compromises, right? There's no one perfect solution for any, you know, per point in the world. And the biggest issue is that we need to have the information, we need to do the analysis, and we need to kind of make a set of priorities for the way that, you know, this is how we think we can make change. And this is what we're gonna put forward. And I think, you know, what we've decided on with Pangaia is to go after our kind of material philosophy, which we've named high-tech naturalism, which is, you know, looking at like how we can take all different kinds of materials around the world, that there's an abundance of agricultural waste, for example, and use new forms of technology, whether that be biotech or new material science or nanotech, and use the augmentation of different kinds of processes to kind of make these things useful as textiles, as fabrics, as materials, as foams or plastics. And that's really where this kind of the cutting edge meets the super low tech, is where we're kind of trying to maneuver our materials. But I think that to me, that's how we really start to move towards a circular economy, which is this return to the bioeconomy, where we have biomass at the center, and that's kind of makes the things around it, being agriculture, food, and energy, kind of part of that interchange on that circle. And so we, as our the future of Pangaia is focused on materials that we consider in this high tech naturalism, so agricultural waste, which is, you know, supplementing cotton. And there's nothing inherently wrong about cotton per se. It is, you know, it as a crop, it's kind of a miracle material, but the way that we farmed it, all the damage that we've done in terms of pesticides and overproduction of cotton,
and the territory, you know, the land and the water amount that it also requires.
So when we look at other crops, we can start to think about the waste product of each of those. So the point is that there's no one, there doesn't need to be one perfect material solution. You know, we can start to use the waste of, say, you know, of bananas, the waste of corn plants, the waste of basically everything, you know, nettles, cypress, there's just so many.
Yeah,
exactly. Citrus, you know, every kind of fruit. You know, we talk about our fruit salad portfolio of materials, right? And so it's really about honing in on the innovation to make each one of those, the fibers from each of those, you know, palatable to the things that we want for fashion, and then to move forward. Oh, and we haven't even touched on all the materials that are available in the ocean. My God, it's just like, I'm a Southern California girl, grew up surfing and scuba diving. And to me, I just feel like the ocean has all the solutions we need. We haven't even explored the deep sea yet to find out what's there. But so that's a priority to say. But I think one of the other things is also for us to look at the things that we want from our fashion products. We're, you know, we live in the age of solutions and innovation, and we shouldn't have to compromise. We don't have to go back to the 19th century. So when you think about innovations like Lycra and spandex, like, we're not going to go back from having good athletic and athleisure wear. So really key is to find, you know, bio-based alternatives for those fabrics. So for the polyesters and so much of our high functional fabrics, the future of kind of that space is based in fossil fuel technology. And that's a kind of a secondary focus of ours, is to really kind of dig in there and say, how do we make, you know, truly biodegradable forms of polyester based things. And again, the science on kind of defining biodegradability, compostability, you know, different industrial levels, you know, I love that my job, you know, being super high tech scientist, is most directly related with farming and landfills, right? Those are kind of the where I go to do research. I always sort of end up in some research paper that has to do with agricultural.
A little bit of brewing as well, no?
What, sorry?
A little bit of brewing as well, no?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Oh yeah, everything, yeah, beer, etc. I know. So yeah, we could maybe we should talk a little bit about biofabrication, because I know that when we were getting to know each other and we were first out there, I think that this idea of talking about synthetic biology, like, how do we explain synthetic biology and biofabrication? And I was always using the beer metaphors to get it across, or this whole idea that the transition of what we think of as factories now, you know, where things get produced, the machines that usually, you know, melt steel and extrude it, et cetera, are now basically cells. So, you know, we go into the bio lab, you extract DNA from an organism, put it into a microorganism, and then grow that organism. And in it, as part of its, you know, metabolic regular cell process, you feed it and it extrudes something. So for example, things like dyes. So, you know, you can program an organism like a microbe to make different colors of dyes. And we're super excited about the future of that. Not quite in product yet, but you know, we're getting close. I think we're only at the tip of what we have planned for Pangaia, which is super exciting. Mir, do you want to talk about some of the things that you're super excited about to kind of come to
life.
Yeah,
I actually just wanted to say that I'm always so impressed by how you can explain in a fun and cool and understandable and easily digestible way, literally the rocket science, you know, and just breakthrough innovation, you know, to everyone, you know, to myself first and foremost, and everyone around us. So yeah, you've done incredible work with that. So thank you. And yeah, I guess maybe to share a couple of really amazing things that we, you know, had a chance already to you know, discover and to meet and to start working with and maybe co-develop some things, you know, be it, you know, a patent or trademark or a product. I guess that is very much, yeah, you know, the spider silk technology, which obviously we believe has huge potential, and there are several big players on that front, and that is something that, yeah, I mean, you know, when you just imagine how that also works, and I think that, Amanda, you will do so much better than myself to really explain again in your super cool fun way how that works. I also believe that that has a great future, same with agri waste, right? So, you know, just to imagine how much we humans you know, consume, I mean, how much we basically create, how much waste we create annually. And you mentioned just a couple of those, right? From citrus to, you know, different others. So basically, instead of bringing that to a landfill, we can give it a second life, right? So imagine a, you know, a future where you're wearing a t-shirt that is made of 100%, you know, citrus waste, or again, banana waste, or a seaweed, you know, that basically, you know, if it's old or something went wrong or whatever, you know, it was damaged, you just know that if it will ever end up on a landfill, it will just organically, naturally, you know, kind of reconnect with, you know, earth and just, you know, biodegrade. And it will not take 200, 500, 1,000 years to biodegrade, if at all. And that is what's happening with all those synthetic materials, right, that we discussed. So polyesters and nylons and all those lycras, yes, those basically everything that has been invented after Second World War is still with us. You know, every tiny piece of, I don't know, I guess, you know, shorts or t-shirts or even, you know, a plastic bag, everything's still here with us on our planet. Yeah. So yeah, we're very much also excited, obviously, about the future of alternatives to all these synthetics. Again, be it, you know, produced with the help of the, you know, this the brute protein, right? The spider, you know.
It's super exciting about the spider silk thing is, like, basically the, some of the companies have gone beyond just what spiders can make. They've taken that DNA, they've understood it, and now they're changing it to even make different, better proteins. So, I mean, that part of it is unbelievable to me, to make kind of all different newly developed proteins. So that's a whole other stream. Like, we talk about, you know, agricultural waste is cellulosic, and protein-based materials is a whole other stream of development, which is just a...
And it's actually everything, right? Like, you, yeah. If you imagine, if you can actually just, you know, think about what can be produced from, you know, yeah. Sparta silk technology, it's not actually just silk. It can be absolutely anything from plastics to cashmere to fur to wool, you know, cotton-like materials, like literally every single thing. You know, every single material and textile that, I guess, almost everything in our life is made of, right? From not just clothing, which is our second skin, which, you yeah. know, we come into contact with every 10 seconds or approximately every day, you know, but it's absolutely everything. It's furniture, it's, you know, tablecloth, it's money that are made of materials and textiles. It's even rockets yeah. that go to space that are made of materials, cars. Those are the building, you know, materials that, you know, and the world and different industries are producing, you know, amazing tools and products for us from. So it's so much broader, you know, than just, I guess, so what we call our second skin, which is clothing.
Yeah, as a kind of point of reflection, you mentioned the communication part of all this. And, like, you know, I struggle to make the science communicable, but also, I mean, you, from your side, you come from a media background, and you've done an incredible job with the vision of Pangaia around kind of philanthropy and kind of collective creativity. And I'm wondering, to me, that is such a huge part about getting the message across that, you know, it's not just like a bunch of nerdy scientists in a back room, right? Like I can be, you know, completely hidden away for 10 years doing something, but how do we get this message out in a way that makes products that people want and with a collective message that also does good while we're making the products and to be sort of authentic around it? You know, this is not a ploy. It's kind of at the, we really believe that like by doing these kind of scientific innovations and coupling them with creativity, we're getting to a different place. So just wonder if you'd maybe talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, remember what Ada Byron Lovelace used to say? She's the first woman the first human in the history who wrote the first code, remember? And it happened like, what, 100 something years ago? She was the daughter of Lord Byron. And so the famous writer. And so she said that magic happens when art, comes together or collaborates or partners with science, right? Mm-hmm. So I guess in our case, what we are trying to do is, really connect the world of science and technology with the world of art and design, right? Yeah. Because also if you remember what, Steve Jobs used to say, when they were just starting Apple, is that design is what's gonna make our company great. So definitely what's extremely important and why this gigantic industry, which is fashion, industry and apparel industry are so big and I guess influential is exactly because it's beautiful, right? It's inspirational and people just, are inspired by beauty. People want, this creativity and again, beauty. It just brings out so many amazing positive feelings out of people, right? And we obviously need more of that. We want as many positive, kind, loving emotions and feelings as possible. So that's exactly what we're trying to do, is to really connect, that's the world of scientists that in my opinion, again, is just really saving the world, every single day coming up with another amazing solution that, every time I end up in another lab, with you or, my mind just really gets, blown away. And,
you mentioned the science and beauty part. So this painting behind me is actually an oil painting of a microscope slide blow up of the bubonic plague. And I'm quarantining with it here in Brooklyn. But this is my favorite piece of art in my house. I've had it for a long time. This is not a quarantine purchase. But I think that seeing the beauty in the side of the science and kind of making that like palatable and kind of sharing that is like, it's a collective part of our human consciousness is I think a bigger part where like science is not a scary thing that's elite and nerdy. It's really like kind of the basis of nature. So I'm gonna switch over to questions because we're actually getting some really good ones. And there's a bunch of different questions about biofabrication. I'm gonna summarize here, but the first one is asking about making it affordable and what are the kind of the stumbling blocks to kind of production, which is a question that we definitely get a lot. And I think the first thing to say is that yes, biofabrication and the kind of startups and companies working in the space, there is a long lead time. It's like they're developing, say, a new biotech innovation, like a new drug or something. There's a whole lot of back-end research and the science of kind of the testing. So for example, if you're working on developing a biofabricated dye, you have to do all sorts of experiments around the DNA, getting that right. How do you actually breed it? What do you feed it? Like, there's just really, really a lot of biological experiments that can't be cut short. They just take time. You have to wait for the organisms to grow, et cetera. So there is a lead up time, which sometimes gets people, they think it's not real or it's fake or, why isn't it coming? And it is coming. It's not a fashion cycle. it's like a 7-year kind of ROI cycle. So that's one thing. The biggest, some of the biggest hurdles to production is, of course, we're talking about an entirely new manufacturing chain. So I think some of the places that we visit, they have to build entirely new like manufacturing structures. So for example, you know, the biofabrication, it basically is closer to brewing beer. So giant vats with growing the organisms than it is to anything that's more typical to a fashion cycle. So we're talking about real disruption inside of the manufacturing chains. And that's another part of kind of, there's, it needs sort of more money and infrastructure to get it to, a huge manufactured size. But the other good thing that's the flip side of that is that once they've figured out the kind of formulation and the growth, it can become totally affordable in the sense that when you think about something like mycelium leather, now that some of the companies have worked out really good ways to produce, once they get to scale, it's gonna be cheaper than luxury leather. It's gonna be at the same quality for sure and even better, but because it's just a plant, it's a root plant. And that's what's so kind of amazing about these things. We no longer have to have the whole infrastructure of livestock, et cetera. So that's where the thing is with biofabrication. Like it's taken a long time and is expensive to do the research, but it really, the reward will be absolutely exponential when we get there. I'm just taking another question here. There's another question around, from someone we know, consumers differentiating between recycled, recyclability, bio-based, biodegradable, and I'm adding in compostable here. And absolutely, this is a huge form of confusion. And to be honest, like we are just kind of figuring out good systems that really try to differentiate from that and how we communicate it. And I'll be clear, like I'm still, there's a lot of confusion even at the kind of highest levels of science about how to, what is going on and how do we talk about it? And we also have to coordinate. This is not just about, fashion industry or creation problem. This is about disposal and much larger societal practices. And there's another question about policy in here. And I think that's one of the things that is the toughest for us to navigate, is that we, as any single company, you can't set the kind of governmental policy on what happens to waste and how it gets collected, and trying to kind of know, create kind of more centralized systems that we really need as cultures to be able to process the science correctly. So that would be my answer to the question about policy. So we're working on trying to create a better communication system around disposal. So what do all those things mean? Different forms of biodegradability versus different forms of compost, et cetera. So first it's to get people educated, and then from there we can try to kind of innovate and disrupt the existing systems. So sort of startups that are working, things like reusable packaging, right? It seems like a simple thing, but when you start dealing with postal services and shipping and international dues, and it suddenly becomes very, very complicated. So I'm just looking here for some other ones. Thanks for saying, really lovely, like they're a nice fan of ours. And how does someone that doesn't have a background in material science get into it, and even more so to run a startup in it? I think that, yeah, that's an interesting question. I think, educate yourself. We live in those times where it's not, there's lots of different resources out there. I think science, and it's particularly,
I think the answer honestly is, if you're not as smart as Amanda, or if you don't have a PhD, like in my case, I guess you just have to be passionately curious and persistent, and that's really, the way to go. And that's really, I guess, what really unites all of us, right, on our on our journey, on our mission. We call it differently every day. So this is really, we're just curious, we're extremely passionate, we're in love with what we do, with these amazing people that we have a pleasure to meet and work with, and I mean anyone, from scientists to industrial designers, to just creative people, marketing people, operational gurus.
Exactly, this point where the scientists can't produce product in a vacuum. Like that's one of the reasons why innovation hasn't made it out of the labs. That's one of the reasons why I'm involved in Pangaia, is because I've seen so many things in labs that aren't being commercialized, and the steps to get from a lab prototype all the way out into a manufactured process are numerous, and they need all different kinds of skills. This is not just kind of science skills, it's business, marketing, everything, production, so the whole chain is really huge. And so someone's asking about working inside of this. I think the best thing you can do is be, you know, work inside of a like a scientific company or somebody who's working on one of these, but be play a different role. And that's absolutely what we need, and be the kind of communicator between all the different systems. I think the more people that can have kind of understanding around it, the more kind of valuable, you know, all these systems are going to be, and the more the kind of the more easily they're going to be adopted into.
Yeah, I guess it's also, you know, as we always say that, you know, we're all a part of, you know, we're like, you know, little parts of this, so, you know, really good watch mechanism, you know.
Yes.
You know, when one stops, you know, working well or just at all, you know, you just, the entire watch, you know, doesn't really show the right time or you know, no time at all. So we're, it's really about, you know, it's my favorite saying that I keep repeating every single day. I think it's my almost like, you know, mantra or motto, that vision and idea is only 1%, while team and execution is 99% of the success. It's really about amazing, passionate people who, you know, come from, you know, different backgrounds with different talents and skills, who complement each other, you know, on and support each other every single day, you know, on different levels. So it's really always a teamwork. I guess we're running out of time, right?
Yeah, yes, so I just gotta say, yeah, thanks to everybody for listening, and we didn't talk about anything about the crisis, because of course, I mean, I think everyone is, but we're so optimistic, and we need to like live in that space and think
we
of,
wanted to share more
it's
positive energy and emotions.
If the good thing can come out of this, that it's an opportunity for us to accelerate the kind of systems change that we need, then it's our, it, you know, it's our responsibility to kind of enable that.